and this is now really sort of already, this has some similarity to this classical picture, right? If you would do a classical description of these weight equations, so you also would solve them by Monte Carlo methods, so there you would really just flip, right? So there's no averages, so you flip your average, and the classical simulation would really just look like steps, right? So at a certain time, it is up or down, and so on. So this quantum evolution here is already showing basically similar features, as I said. So one point is that, this is already happening, sort of, not so large decay rates, right? So this is the largest coherent driving frequency in our system, so this omega 1, as I said. And you see already, if this is only a factor of 2 smaller, then this gamma is sort of getting dynamics which is quite close to this classical limit. Right? So this weight equation here is apparently not so bad. You see a more quantitative description of the spectrum for the small 2 by 4 levels, so showing the total Rydberg error number as a function of your upper state laser detuning, and you see it follows this quite nicely. And at some point, when you go to too large detunings, actually the coherence is getting more and more important, and so they deviate, but the main region that we will be interested anyway, it's only here, so for the purposes of what I'm going to show you a little bit later, so this is actually, so these weight equations are doing a very good job. But the blue line, okay, so I can say this, the blue line is the classical, and the solution of these classical weight equations, and these dots show you sort of averages over these quantum trajectories for different tunings. All right, so this all seems to make sense, so now the idea is then to use these classical weights to describe very large systems, so that we can do very easily, because now it's classical, everything just scales linearly with the particle number, so there we can really simulate millions, if you wish, of atoms. For 1 million, let's say, probably not millions, so up to 1 million. And so one result is shown here now, so again from spectrum. Now, as I said, for larger particle numbers, for different sizes of your two-dimensional lattices, so 30 times 30, 90 times 90, one with a length of 150. And what you see is that at least the number or fraction of Rydberg atoms converges quite quickly. So we are already well in the thermodynamic limit, even for these 30 times 30 lattices. And what you also see that there's not much happening here, right? So there's a smooth curve, there's no sign of any transitions or no of change or anything. So there you really don't see a whole lot, which may be disappointing in the first place, but it's also understandable because, so in this case, the Rydberg atom number, so in contrast to the things that I showed you yesterday, it's not really measuring any, or you can't really use it as a proper measure of correlations. And so what we, and then instead, what you can do is not really make use of these two sublattices, or this picture of these two sublattices, if we are looking for this type of ordering, and define an order parameter which is not really measuring populations on the sublattice. And this you can do this way, and then we very simply for counting atoms, so this is this projector onto the Rydberg state, so we count the number of Rydberg excitations on, on each of the sublattices, so A or B, and this is done by this B factor, so this is so minus 1 to the sum of the actual coordinate, and if you look at this, then sublattice B is characterized by an even number of the sum, right? So every blue dot, and this number is even, for every red dot, this number is odd, so then this whole thing becomes negative, so what this this order parameter actually gives you is not a population difference between sublattice A and sublattice B. Right? And therefore you would expect, so if I get long-range order, if most of it is on A, I will get close to 1, if most of it is on B, I get close to 1, but if I randomly distribute this parameter, should be close to 0. And that's actually what you see. So what's shown here now is now sort of results of these classical Monte Carlo simulations, assuming a nearest neighbor interaction. So it's essentially really realizing this standard Hertzsprung model. If you are on resonance, so for zero detuning, interactions are 5, so not infinitely large, so we don't have a full exclusion as I showed here. But you actually see that you basically recover this Hertzsprung or the predictions of this Hertzsprung model pretty well already. From B equal to 5. So if you remember this critical values that I gave you, that are 0.79 something, and that's pretty much what we see in these simulations. Right? So different system sizes, if you go even larger, at some point you will see a sharp transition around a little bit less than 0.8 as a function of this excitation probability. So that's nice, so this resembles this classical Hartzell model, as I said. So here you would really expect to see crystalline states. And the surprising thing was, in my opinion, so that's actually the most surprising result of the things I'm going to show you, is actually that it doesn't happen. Right? And I found it surprising because these nearest neighbor interactions or these approximations are actually used quite frequently on the theory side, especially for lattices. And here's now an instance where you see that this really badly failed. So what I'm showing here now is again this order parameter and this, like, the probabilities that are very close to 1, so actually where you would expect very nice lattice, and then plotting out this order parameter as a function of the exponent of your interactions. Okay, in our Rydberg atoms, that would be sitting somewhere here. From the nearest neighbor approximation, I would expect for any, the predictions would be this line up here, so where this, these points converge to. And what you actually see is that for a large range, so for potentials that drop very, very quickly with an exponent of even around 10 or 11, you don't see any crystallization. So that means with this nearest neighbor approximation, which naively you would think is a very good thing to do, so it fails qualitatively in this case. So it gives you totally different physics, which, for example, wouldn't happen if I would look at these unitary evolutions. So if I would look at these ground state phases that we did yesterday, so they are typically for these parameters, these tails of the interaction, they only give you a tiny correction. In this case, they qualitatively change the physics. You really have to go to very, very steeply dropping potentials, and then you get in this case a second order phase transition to this first line phase. And you actually approach this beam field limit, as you see, also very, very slowly, and then for very, very large exponents, so you are getting onto these nearest neighbor predictions. So that was unexpected, but on the one hand, also a bit disappointing, because so now still we don't have any crystalline states for the Rydbergs. But there's still one parameter to tune. And this, as I will show you, will finally save today, and that's the laser detuning. Right, so this you can still change. If you do that, then you lose the style connection to the Hartzell model, so you can't really picture this in terms of a constraint or a nearest neighbor constraint. But there's a parameter we can still tune, and the idea is that if I do this, then I can sort of try to compensate for these next nearest neighbor interactions that I will get on the lattice. Right? And the major contribution then will probably come from Adam sitting on the diagonal. It's now a very simple picture. So if you have this lattice, and suppose now we have prepared, so do it by hand, such an interferometric state, right? So now and I'm sitting here, so then actually these, or the reason why I wouldn't get this crystal, why this crystal would not be the stable phase, is obviously the remaining interactions on this diagonal. And now for R to the 6, which is producing the nearest neighbor interaction, over 8. And then the idea is that I'm now looking for transitions, or for the location of a possible transition. You remember, so this excitation probability, or this critical excitation fraction was 0.7 something, so you have an average of about 3 neighbors on this diagonal. Now if I require that this detuning should compensate for this, I obviously need a positive detuning, so to make this term as small as possible, such that my overall excitation probability in such a configuration would exceed a certain threshold. So this gives you some estimate of the phase boundary, and indeed, so if you do the numerics, then you really find sort of finite values of this lattice, of this interferometric order parameter, as you change your tuning, and pretty much at the right size, at the right value. So if you take this expression here, so you get lines that are kind of close to these numerical results. So you get, at least for these finite systems, you get large values of this Q, so close to 1. For probabilities that are not too close to 1, right? So the ratio of these omegas doesn't have to be too extreme. And then here this is shown as a function of the tuning and against
action strength, you see there's also a finite window, if you wish, of opportunity where you would expect to see these crystalline phases. And so at some point you get a transition again for large interactions to your totally disordered liquid like state, and this you can also understand. So if I make the B too large, then actually I have no chance to overcome this nearest neighbor or next nearest neighbor interactions. And if I make it too small, I don't have a constraint. So there's really a finite regions of interactions. So here more than units of your width of your steady state, then you get these crystalline phases. Alright, so with this I'm almost at the end. So here I'm just showing an extrapolation to the large system size limit. So as I said so before, this is for finite sizes, so if you're really talking about long range order, you should check that this maxima really persists. So this is shown here now, sort of doing simulations for different sizes of your lattices and then extrapolating to infinity, and you see that you really get two continuous or second order phase transitions from a liquid to a crystalline state and then back to a re-entrant liquid as you change the tuning. And these lines here that I'm showing you is just to illustrate that there's really quite a difference. So this is the predictions of a mean field theory. So this dotted line is the prediction of a mean field theory with nearest neighbor interactions. And this is a bit extended version of the things that I've shown you before. So this is again mean field, but now including the next nearest neighbor interactions. So you get a bit different equations, but you can still solve them. And you see that so the point that I'm trying to make here is actually that it's not really the range of the potential which gives you this long prediction of a resonant crystallization, but it's really the mean field. And on the quantitative level, you see that both of these fail very badly, so it's actually both for the range of the potential and sort of classical correlations which determine really the phase diagram for the actual properties of these crystalline phases. Alright, so just to finish this, so finally we did some dynamical simulations, so using these weights that I showed you before, and here for particular numbers, so for medium with favorable atoms, so now a low lying state, so 35S, so if you remember sort of these numbers that I showed you yesterday for these optical lattices, this was around, well, this was 43, but then we got a propane radius which is covering roughly 6-7 lattice heights, so we only want to have a nearest neighbor constraint, so you have to make the excitation level a bit lower, which in these coherent settings would be a problem because the decay rate gets larger and larger. So here it's actually not an issue because anything is decaying over these time scales anyway, so you can make these triplet levels smaller, so you get smaller interactions. And what I'm showing here is for these RV frequencies. So the decay rate for medium is 6 megahertz, so these two RV frequencies also are on the order of 2 megahertz. And what's showing here is now first of all the number of triplet atoms or the fraction of excited atoms. So now for two different tunings, so you would expect a liquid phase or a crystalline phase for this red line. And again, consistent with what I showed before, so you don't really see any difference either in the time scale for the relaxation, you know, in the absolute final steady state value. But if you now measure this Q parameter, which in principle you could measure by this imaging techniques that I briefly explained. And yesterday, you really see this pronounced difference in the evolution. So here you get a liquid-like state, so it's still finite. Because in this case, the lattice is quite small, so 20 times 20 atoms. But already for these sizes, you see a qualitative difference. So in this crystalline region, you get something which is certainly undetectable. Just to illustrate how this obviously evolves, basically these longer time scales come about because these atoms now slowly have to relax, so it's really connected to like percolation of a large cluster. Like, so initially you will quickly fill up your lattice. So maybe I should explain what it's actually shown here. So these gray regions are now sort of positions where you don't have a Rydberg excitation, like, so these gray lines are empty or ground state atoms. Then the black lines or the black dots are sort of an excitation on one sublattice, and the white dots are an excitation on the other sublattice. What you see here is that very quickly, so on these time scales, you basically fill up your system, right? So you squeeze in as many atoms as you can, right? So this number gets close to 1.5. But your system is not really ordered. So now it takes some time to actually flip and move these excitations around, and then after a longer time, so showing you that it's long relaxation time, you actually get this, you get percolation and you find a large cluster, which then sort of shows long range order extending over your whole system. But overall, this unfortunately doesn't take too much time, so you have, so for this 20 times 20, you get this within a few tens of microseconds, which is still short enough, for example, to avoid heating from this decay, which is constantly going on. This seems to be something which may be possible in experiments. All right, so that's pretty much it. So just to summarize, so now for this part, so the point I wanted to make, so that there is indeed some long-range ordering, so this has been under discussion for the last 2 years, in fact, so then from these classical simulations, you see that you can have long-range correlations in these dissipative systems. But what you basically, the message is that you really have to be careful now. Also, if you look at these dissipative situations, first of all, with mean field predictions, and also somewhat unexpected, also by the way how you approximate your Rydberg interaction. So that's something, so these nearest neighbor models, as I said, are something which has been quite popular. So what this is showing here is that, in some cases, you really should carefully check these approximations. Alright, so but in the end, so what I've shown here is now was only one limit, right? So we still haven't been able to fully or to solve this full quantum evolution equation. So this was a strong Dangle limit, where in fact everything what I've shown is purely classical, right? So there's no entanglement in the system, so everything is driven by classical correlations. So then obviously it would be very interesting now to go to weaker damping or essentially increase your Rabi frequencies. And I showed you results for this 1D and 2-level situations from these stochastic wave function methods. At the moment, it really seems like that so 2D situations with 3 levels is really something which is out of the scale of numerical simulations. So in particular, if you want to look at long-range ordering, so for these lattices, so this would be something which is not possible on a classical computer at the moment. And there again, we come to the point that all of these experiments are quite important or interesting as quantum simulators where you really can answer questions that don't seem to be doable in the foreseeable future on the theory side. And then again, so there's also extensions, so this has already been looked into this recent work also by Tony Lee, Richard Lukin, and co-workers. So they looked at a more sort of general form of the spin models, and now containing X, Y, and Z interactions, right? So what I talked about was only sigma z, sigma z. So now if you add more and you add dissipation, so they found from very much the same mean field models that I described, so they find an even richer structure of the phase diagram, so they get all sorts of ordering depending on your parameters, so paramagnetic phases, wind density waves, ferromagnets, and antiferromagnets, so the physics. Just to illustrate this, so this can be much richer again if you have different types of interactions. But the point I just want to make here is that basically all these additional effects or classical correlations, so they haven't been taken into account here. And that's, I think, that's really something that one would have to understand in the future, also in these more general models, or these nearest neighbor assumptions, if you want to realize this with Rydberg errors, as described here, really do, and what all correlations actually play on the classical and on the quantum level. And at the moment, so there's lots of room also on the theory side to understand these things. Okay, so that's it. Finally, I want to talk to people that have actually worked on the things I showed you in the end. And this is, first of all, Wilram Abdusalam, who is actually our PhD student in this coherence center, who couldn't come to this meeting, and Georg Banasch, who's worked on this in the beginning, or by the time he already left our group. And all of this was done in collaboration with to Michael Ritz and Carlos Lauter, so Michael Fleischhauer, and Michael Wenig, so who also did these simulations and the theory. Okay, that's it. Thank you.